Hi, welcome to Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. I'm Julia Locandy. Senator, it's great to see you again.
Well, it's good to be here.
Last week, we were talking about the budget, and I'd like to continue that discussion today. So what was decided to be the answer for the new federal tax code reform?
Well, I don't think it's the answer, but what was in the budget was basically attempts that the governor had proposed to provide more tax relief for the state taxpayer in view of the federal new tax changes. Now, first of all, the 80% of the New Yorkers are supposed to benefit right now without any changes from the new federal tax code. You're going to pay less taxes. That's number one. But the one that the people that are hurt the most were really the more high-income individuals, because what the federal government did in its tax code was limit the amount of deduction that you could have on the federal tax return for taxes you pay in the state of New York. So if you're a high-income person or have a property value that's very high for your home and you're paying high taxes, the limit of the taxes that you pay to the state of New York that you can deduct from the federal went down to $10,000. That's devastating to a lot of high-income taxpayers. Well, in his State of the State message, the governor talked about this and how there's a war against New York State and a missile coming in and all that jazz, which I thought was extremely ironic because he keeps talking about the middle class is what he really cares about, not the upper class. And secondly, he had no problem approving a millionaire's tax on millionaires that they pay an additional surcharge on their tax. Now he all of a sudden he's worried about that group of taxpayers, which everybody should be worried about everybody rather than having these class warfare. But the class warfare didn't bother him that much this year because he's running for governor again and thinks he's going to be president. So with that editorial comment, what ended up happening, the Senate first, what they did is when there's certain deductions in your state tax return that are dependent upon what federal deductions you get. And automatically, by losing the federal deductions, you were losing it for your state tax returns as well. So the Senate recognized that and immediately corrected that with legislation. The Assembly didn't pass it, but we pushed it in the budget, and it was passed. So if you're receiving a difficult tax result from the federal tax return and your high income, that was pretty much corrected as far as not losing those same deductions on your state return. So that was corrected by the Senate, the legislature, the Assembly, and the governor didn't do anything, but it was finally done in the budget. So that double whammy was eliminated. The governor had two other proposals that one was to create charitable trusts in each school district. Basically, the theory is that you since you have a limit of the amount of taxes you can deduct from on your federal tax return, those people paying high property taxes in the state of New York, what the governor says, well, we'll make it a charitable deduction, not taxes. Well, we'll have these tax trusts created in each school district throughout the state, and you could pay what used to be taxes as charitable contributions to your school district. Now, to me, the federal government does a lot of things wrong, and sometimes they don't do it too smartly, but I can't imagine anybody can't see through that as a clear way to avoid taxes by just calling it something else. And so I, while this debate was going on, I sent a letter to the IRS and said, look, the state of New York is debating this. Is this a legitimate vehicle to avoid those taxes? Well, they wrote back eventually and basically said, we can't give you any prejudgments as to what's what. We will just decide how we're going to handle it if people create these trusts and the taxpayers in the state of New York try to use them. To me, it's in the budget, but the chances of that being successful are slim and none in my mind. So it may be just a thought that you might get some help. The other one was a changing the tax code so the taxes that you normally would pay that are pulled out of your your returns, the state of New York, through an idea of the governor's, would basically have the employer pay those taxes first, and the employee gets a net check. And that process is voluntary. Employers can decide whether they want to do it or not. I can't imagine too many employers doing that because, again, it's a gimmick. It's not really a real, I don't think it's going to be a real benefit to anybody. But what it also does, which didn't get talked about too much, if I'm making $70,000 a year and instead the employer is going to take out $5,000, so I'm only making $65,000 now because that's the net I'm getting, the taxes have been covered, but what about my pension or what about benefits that I receive? What about my Social Security? Am I basing that on 65 rather than 70? And there's all of these ancillary issues that clearly are going to make it very difficult for any employer to go forward before there's some clear indication from the federal government whether this thing is actually a legitimate way to deal with this tax issue.
So a lot of this is just like figuring out what you want, where you want to go, how you want to do it.
It's figuring out why you want to do it, but if the employer is the one who makes the determination, I can't imagine too many employers changing their whole structure of paying if they don't even know if the federal government is going to buy it. I can't imagine school districts saying we're going to create this trust until there's a clear indication of the feds whether this is just a game that they can see through or whether it's going to work. So it's an attempt, which is, I guess that in and of itself is a good thing. However, the chances I think that they'll be successful are very slim.
So the Star Property Tax Rebate Program, that was expanded.
Right. It was expanded actually in last year's budget. It was a multi-year expansion. And the question was whether the governor this year was going to take the expansion away because of the lack of revenues. Well, he put it in his budget that he's going to take the expansion away. But we in the legislature put it back in so that actually your rebate checks are going to be double by all estimations of what they were in the past years.
Great. So as for methods to help businesses create jobs, the Economic Development Program Startup New York, was that continued through this budget?
Yes, it was. And even if it was going to be continued, the sad part about it is that it wasn't modified in any way. Wow. It wasn't modified, so there's more oversight. I have a bill that was a controller's bill that basically required more oversight by the controller's office rather than one individual, the governor, making all these determinations.
Which is how it was done before, right?
And that's how it's going to continue to be done. And that was one of the Senate's main proposals, was to have more transparency, and also have more accountability on the regional economic development councils. And that went off the table. As far as items that went off the table that surely should be dealt with before the end of session, that's one of my priorities.
All right, so $1 billion more for education this year. How will it be distributed fairly?
Well, fairness is in the eye of the beholder. If you're getting a substantial increase, you think it's fair. If your increase isn't as much as others, you don't think it's fair. And that fairness issue will never be resolved until there is a new state aid formula which provides the most funding to poorer districts and low wealth districts, and that's the ongoing issue. When we had a bill one time, I had it, and then when the Democrats for a short time took over the Senate, Dave Valesky had it. We both tried to pass it, which would have been a much fairer system and a more transparent system, so you know why everyone is getting what they're getting, rather than a patchwork group of bills that turn out to be the state aid formula. And it's the politics of it that makes it difficult to change. If you're being treated well, you don't want to change it. If you're not being treated well, you do. Mm-hmm. And the state aid formula, like everything else in government, is you got to have the votes. And if the votes are there, you can get a change. If they're not, you can't.
Right. So I remember you pointing out that you wanted to make sure new funding was added to the communities impacted by the historic flooding, Lake Ontario and St. Lawrence River. Was that in the budget?
Yes, but it wasn't necessarily that much more money. It was that it's got to be released. There's money in the budget, but homeowners and people that were damaged by the flooding have this concern that the money is supposed to be there. We've made our applications. Nothing is getting released, so we're still sitting here in limbo. And I think we corrected it as best we can, but it's always up to the chief administrator of the state, chief executive, namely the governor, to get that moving. And hopefully he's going to do that. If he doesn't, then hopefully someone will beat him in November.
Yeah, there was a similar thing that happened with the Sandy, Superstorm Sandy, and then people trying to get the funding for that.
Exactly. It's a massive undertaking. I don't want to be too negative. Massive undertaking when there's that much damage. But on the other hand, as far as the flooding is concerned, Lake Ontario, it's been some time since this has happened. Plenty of time, if there was a good administration, to get the dollars that are meant to be delivered to those damaged a lot quicker than they have been.
All right. Now, what about environmental and clean water projects?
Yes, money was increased in those areas as well, and to everyone's credit. The one question that people might have, I thought we had a $4 billion deficit. We're increasing money for all of these things, including $1 billion for education. Increasing taxes by $1 billion. How does that happen? That's the mystery of Albany. And the mystery of Albany is basically what ended up happening is estimates for what dollars are coming in from taxpayers were increased substantially because the stock market was going up, the money's received from Wall Street for taxes, substantially greater than were anticipated. They re-estimated certain expenses, and the expenses were lowered from what they thought they would be. And it's a little shell game. And whether that shell game was done fairly or not, we'll know very quickly. And that means beginning of next year, you'll see if there's a substantially greater deficit since we didn't deal with the problem this year.
All right. So talk about the additional dialogue that's needed for items that fell off the table.
Well, the one I mentioned already dealt with the changing the Startup New York program. I've given many examples in my district alone where companies were built factories and never showed up without penalty.
Right.
There's got to be others and others reviewing these projects before they're approved. Monitoring the projects as they go forward, and there's got to be penalties, and there's got to be more disclosure. So that's one other area. That's to me the most important area as far as I'm concerned, because we keep spending millions and millions of dollars on projects that aren't providing the jobs that are billed to be provided by the governor.
Mm-hmm. What about school safety? I was really surprised I didn't see that in the budget.
Well, the Assembly wanted more gun control. The Senate wanted the school safety measures, including metal detectors, including at least one armed police officer in the schools. And it seems so logical to me that the most vulnerable people should have some protection. The governor doesn't have to worry about it. He's got cops around him every time he takes a step. Some of these famous people that are including Congress and members, people that are wealthy individuals from the movie industry, all of whom are crying for more gun control. They don't have to worry. They got bodyguards, and they've got police around them. But what about the schools? It just seems to me there ought to be some effort to provide protection, because you can't stop every nutcase that's out there. Mm-hmm. And Assembly wouldn't go for it. We tried to negotiate it in the budget. It didn't happen. And that is something that is also a very big priority. We got to protect the kids.
Right. It's not only about hardening the targets. There was also some really good mental health components to that.
Exactly. Exactly. Yep.
All right. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on the budget, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.